الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. In this month of Shawwal, a great battle took place, the Ghazwa. The battle of Uhud took place on the 3rd of Shawwal, in the 3rd year of Hijrah, at the valley located in front of Mount of Uhud. Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu says, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن أحدا جبل يحبنا ونحبه. Verily, the mountain of Uhud loves us and we love it, subhanAllah. And hence we make ziyarah because we love it. May Allah place His love in our hearts.
Amen.
The defeat at Badr was such an embarrassment and a humiliation which the Quraysh pride could not leave unavenged. So revenge was therefore the catchword all over Makkah. In the battle of Badr, Hind's father, brother and uncle were killed. Her anger at the Muslims was really immense. She wailed and she shrieked for days and wandered the desert pouring sand on her face and clothes, until her husband assured her that the death of her family would be avenged. She promised a reward for the one who would bring back to her the heart of Hamza, who was responsible for her father's and brother's death. Abu Sufyan nursed the most grudge against the Muslims because he had lost heavy economic losses. Quraysh started fresh preparation to launch an overall war against the Muslims in order to restore their blemished prestige and wounded pride. They were determined to crush the Commonwealth of Islam once and for all. It was also decided that the profits of the escaped caravan headed by Abu Sufyan, which amounted to 1,000 camels and 50,000 dinars, should be devoted for providing equipment to the army. And the Noble Quran has alluded to this decision of this in the following words: بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين كفروا ينفقون أموالهم ليصدوا عن سبيل الله. Verily, those who disbelieve spend their wealth to hinder people from the path of Allah. فسينفقونها ثم تكون عليهم حسرة ثم يغلبون. So will they continue to spend it, but in the end it will become a regret for them. Then they will be overcome. They also devised other ways of recruitment, including hiring poets to entice the tribes into fighting the Muslims. A contingent of 3,000 warriors, of whom 700 were armed soldiers and 200 well-mounted cavalry, with 3,000 camels and 15 women, marched towards Medina. The general leader was Abu Sufyan. The cavalry under the leadership of Khalid bin Walid, he was not a Muslim at the time, and was assisted by Ikrimah bin Abu Jahl, and Bani Abdad was entrusted with the flag. The Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam held a military consultation assembly to exchange views about the situation. The Prophet alayhi salam offered a suggestion that his companions should not go out of Medina, that they should encamp themselves within the city. He was of opinion that the enemy should be left in the open to exhaust themselves, and thus the Muslims would not risk a battle. But in the thought of attacking Medina, the Muslim men would be ready to fight them at the lanes, at the gullies of Medina, whereas the Muslim women would help from over the house roofs, the rooftops in other words. Abdullah bin Ubay, the head of the monastics, the hypocrites, who attended the meeting as the chief, supported the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's plan. His agreement was not based on the righteousness of the plan, but rather on his personal benefit. He didn't want to fight He secretly aimed at being far away from the faith. However, it was Allah's will that he should be exposed and disgraced in public. And it was rightly done so. Some of the companions who had missed the jihad in Badr suggested that the Prophet ﷺ should go up to Medina and urged him to accept the viewpoint. One of them said, Ya Rasulullah ﷺ, for a long time we have been looking forward to this day and we have implored Allah to make such a day draw near. Thanks to Allah, it is time to fight. So let us go out and fight our enemies, lest they should think that we have lost heart and do not dare to fight them. Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib, the paternal uncle of the Prophet, who was heroic at Badr, was ahead of those who were enthusiastic and urged him to go out and meet the disbelievers. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Wallahi, who has sent a book down unto you, I will not taste food till I fight them with my sword outside Medina. It was decided that the enemy should be resisted outside the city at Uhud. Nabi alayhi salam ascended the minbar at the Friday khutbah. And the Prophet alayhi salam urged the people in khutbah to fight courageously. Ya ayyuhal ladina amanu اصبروا وصابروا ورابطوا واتقوا الله لعلكم تفلحون. Oh, you who believe, be patient and excel in patience and remain steadfast and be careful of your duty to Allah that you may be successful. Then he commanded his men to make ready for battle, and most of them rejoiced greatly. He led the afternoon prayer with the crowds of people. Then he entered his house accompanied by his two friends, Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu. They helped him dress and wear his amala. He armed himself and wore two armors, one over the other. He wore his sword and he went out to meet the people. The people were now waiting impatiently. Sa'ad bin Mu'adh and Husayn blamed people for pressing on the Prophet and forcing him. They said, you have forced Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to fight the enemy outside Medina. Therefore, they were determined to leave the whole matter to the Prophet and blame themselves for what they had already done. When the Nabi alayhi salam came out, they said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we should not have disagreed with you. So you are free to do what you desire. If you prefer to stay inside Medina, we will stay with you. Upon this, the Nabi alayhi salam said, it does not become a prophet that once he had put on his armor, he should take it off until Allah has decided between him and the enemy. In other words, you don't turn back. In our old people, for example, they said, you know, when you take the bride or the groom out of the house, I remember, then they say, oh, I forgot the ring, or I forgot my scarf. And the elderly people will say, no, you can't turn around, you wait here, we'll go fix it for you. Subhanallah. Look at the hikmah they had. The Prophet divided his army into three battalions. The army consisted of 1,000 fighters, 100 of them armed, another 50 horsemen. The departure was announced and the army moved forward. As night fell upon them, they performed the jam salah. And then, of course, the munafiq Abdullah bin Umayy, the hypocrite, rebelled against the Muslims and left with his 300 fighters. He said, we do not know why we shall kill ourselves. Typical munafiqs. The real purpose of this rebellion was to create havoc. That was basically. And then if the Muslims lose, then the munafiq will take over the presidency. That was his aim. That's it. But Allah says about these hypocrites, وَلِيَعْلَمَ الَّذِينَ نَافَقُوا وَقِلَّ لَهُمْ, and that he might test the hypocrites. It was said to them, تَعَالُوا قَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَوْ اِنْفَعُوا. Come, fight in the way of Allah. At least defend yourselves. قَالُوا لَوْ نَعْلَمُ قِتَالًا لَاتَّبَعْنَاكُمْ. They said, had we known that fighting will take place, we would certainly have followed you. هم للكفر يومئذ أقرب منهم للإيمان. They were that day nearer to disbelief than to iman, to faith. يقولون بأفواههم ما ليس في قلوبهم. Saying with their mouths what was not in their hearts. Let Allah protect us from that. والله أعلم بما يكتمون. And Allah has full knowledge of what they concealed. After the rebellion and withdrawal of the hypocrites, the numbers of the soldiers were reduced to 700. The Prophet alayhi salam, being the master military strategist, he mobilized our army and into two rows to prepare them for fight. And then he selected, as you all know, 50 skillful archers that formed a squad and made them under the command of Abdullah bin Zubayr. And he ordered them to stay in where they are and clarify the mission of his squad in the words. He said, drive off the horses from us by means of arrows, lest they should attack us from behind. Whether we win the battle or lose it, stand steadily in your position and mind that we are not being attacked from your side. It was basically the rank. That was the rules. If you see us snatched into pieces by birds, do not leave this position of yours till I send for you. And if you see that we have defeated the enemy and trodden on them, do not desert your position till I send for you. SubhanAllah, how clear that could the Prophet be. It was a wise and carefully laid out plan, which revealed the genius of the military leadership that the Prophet Muhammad possessed. Even the Quraysh women participated in the battle, led by the wife of Abu Sufyan, Hind bin Uqbah. They wandered among the rows of the idolaters, tapped on their tambourines, encouraged the men to fight and aroused the emotions of heroes, lancers, their swordsmen and the brave fighters. At one time they addressed them, O Bani Abdar, O Bani Abdar, O home of the defenders, strike with your sword. And at another time they would wave people's encouragement and zeal by singing, if you fight bravely, we will embrace and unfold mats to welcome you. But if you flee from the battlefield, we will leave you, desert you, and love you no more. Look at the black words, these ladies and subhanAllah. Eventually, because of time constraints, Wahshi was hired and promised his freedom. That if you kill Hamza, the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, stealthily, you shall be freed. The archers upon whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam located on the mountain had the upper hand, administering the war activities to go in favor of the Muslims. Khalid bin Walid, as I mentioned, was not Muslim at the time, had three times attacked the left wing of the Muslim army with the aim of crushing it and to create confusion and disorder, but he was and his people were repelled. While the small army of Islam were on their way to another clear victory over the Makkans, the majority of the archers on the mountainside committed a fatal mistake that turned the whole situation upside down and constituted a source of heavy losses amongst the Muslims. 40 archers deserted their posts, enticed by the roar of victory, as well as the greed for spoils of war. Only 9 under Abdullah, the leader, decided to abide. The shrewd Khalid bin Walid at the time saw this golden opportunity to turn swiftly around the rear of the Muslim army. And they came back, ya Allah, and they created heavy losses. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was then amongst a small group of fighters. But the genius of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he raised his voice calling out to his companions, Ya Ibadallah! But it came at the cost that the Nabi alayhi salam was injured. Subhanallah. The Quran describes this. لقد صدقكم الله وعده إذ تحصونهم بإذنه. And Allah very made good his promise unto you when you routed them by his leave. حتى إذا فشلتم وتنازعتم في الأمر. until the moment when your courage failed you and you disagreed about the order. وَعَصَيْتُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا أَرَاكُمْ مَا تُحِبُّونَ. And you disobeyed after he has shown you that for which you long. مِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الدُّنْيَا وَمِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةِ. Some of you desire the world and some of you desire the hereafter. ثُمَّ صَرَفَكُمْ عَنْهُمْ لِيَبْتَلِيَكُمْ وَلَقَدْ عَفَى عَنْكُمْ. Therefore he made you flee from them that he might test you, yet now he has forgiven you. وَاللَّهُ ذُو فَضْلٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah is a Lord of kindness to the believers. Alhamdulillah. إِذْ تُسْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْغُونَ عَلَى أَحْدٍ. Remember when you fled and climbed the mountain without looking aside at anyone? وَالْرَسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاهُ. While the messenger was calling you from behind. فَأَثَابَكُمْ غَمًّا بِغَمٍ لِكَيْ لَا تَحْزَنُوا عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ. So Allah repaid you with distress upon distress. So you would not grieve for that which you had escaped you. In other words, the victory and spoils of war. وَلَا مَا أَصَابَكُمْ. Or for that which you had fallen of injury and death. وَاللَّهُ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. And Allah is well acquainted with what you do. At the battlefield, many of the bodies of the Muslims were mutilated. Ya Allah. They cut off their ears, their noses, their genitals. Even their bellies were cut open and part of it was taken and they should make it like a necklace. This is what the Kuffar did, subhanAllah. Him ripped open the liver of Hamza radiallahu anhu. She chewed it and spat it out. She even made the ears and noses of Muslims into anklets and necklaces. Ya Allah. The Prophet found the body of his beloved uncle. And he said, there will never be a moment as sad for me as this. I tell you that no one has been wounded in Allah's cause, but Allah will remember him on the day of resurrection and will raise him from the dead. Because they were buried as they had fallen as martyrs, as shuhada. وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا. And never think of those who have been killed in the cause of Allah as dead. بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. Rather they are alive with their Lord, receiving sustenance, provisions. فَرِحِينَ بِمَا أَتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Rejoicing in what Allah has bestowed upon them of His bounty. وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ بِالَّذِينَ لَمْ يَلْحَقُوا بِهِمْ مِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ. And they receive good tidings about those to be martyred after them who have not yet joined them. Allah خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. That there will be no fear concerning them, nor will they grieve. يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ بِنِعْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ. They receive good tidings of favor from Allah and bounty. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ أَجْرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. SubhanAllah. The Muslims realize that their defeat had been caused by the disobedience of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Quran tells the Muslims, had been tested by Allah at Uhud and had failed, but Allah forgave them their weakness. وَمَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا نُؤْتِهِ مِنْهَا. And whoever desires the reward of this world, we shall give him thereof. وَمَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الْآخِرَةِ نُؤْتِهِ مِنْهَا. And whoever desires the reward of the hereafter, we will give him thereof. وَسَنَجِ الشَّاكِرِينَ. And we will reward the grateful. Just to end off, the lessons learned of Uhud. Victory is not guaranteed for Muslims. We need an impossible war in the Battle of Badr. May some people think that they will be held by Allah and that victory is a favor guaranteed by Allah. But of course, life doesn't work that way. Though it is Allah's right to grant it, we have to set our own ways for victory. We have to earn that victory. Likewise, the glory of Islam in the future may be guaranteed, but we have to work as such so that it can be realized in this world. Yes, Allah is favorable to us. Isn't that so? Doesn't mean we must sit down and wait for the rizq to come. We have to go out and look for it. That is it. It also, number two, it teaches you how to forbear tragedies and losses. In the face of defeat, tragedy and losses, you must establish the reason between cause and effect. Do not be overly emotional, but rather learn from it to avoid future failure. And notice what you did right and wrong so you can always use it in the future occasions. Number three, what to do when you suffer defeat. Whenever we suffer defeat, we are to blame ourselves. Take account of ourselves. Hasibuku, isn't that something? Take qabla al tuhas. Take stock of ourselves before stock is taken of us. Yeah. Take account of ourselves and repent from our sins. Realize our own mistakes and promise yourself that you will act in a different and better way so that you can get different, better results next time. Defeat is a good time to let go of our ego because the results do not discriminate. Number four, obedience to the messenger is very important. It is such a significant matter for this belief as exemplified in this part of Islamic history. Disobedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam carry a negative consequences, as the archers in Uhud have experienced themselves. Allah protect them. Disobedience and greed is a reason for defeat. Point number five. Along with disobedience, greed is also an enemy of victory. Victory requires steadfastness, but disobedience and greed will distract you from being steadfast. If you want to succeed in fighting for this religion, fight your disobedience and fight your sense of greed. Then number six, penultimate point. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, stay kind to people. In a beautiful manner was spoken about in Surah Imran, I'm leaving out the Arabic. So by the mercy from Allah, you were lenient with them. And if you had been rude in speech and harsh in heart, لَنْفَقْدُوا مِنْ حَوْلِكِ, they would have run away from you. This leniency and softness motivated the people to fight harder and strive to obey more, which proved fruitful for the struggle. When people make mistakes, it does not mean you can be rude to them. Stay kind to people, even after they did wrong. Give people another chance, and do not let their mistakes distract you from being unified. Hate the act, not the person, as I mentioned in the week. Hate the act, not the person. Now, the last point. It teaches you to have hope. Defeat and victory is not permanent. The wheels will keep on turning. If you keep them moving, the wheels will keep on turning. A rolling stone gathers no moss. Even the cops say this, a rolling stone gathers no chamos. After the battle of Uhud, they worked hard for victory for the battle of Khandaq. They come back stronger and make your defeat a useful lesson. Take advantage of your mistake and let it be the foundation of your advantages for the future, inshallah. In short, thank you for listening to these lessons of Uhud. May we imbibe within our lives. Alhamdulillah.